As you can see here, and as you'll already know, if you've been watching my live streams over the past couple of months, I have been printing up a storm on the Snapmaker 2 A350. Why? Well, one, because I've needed to print some of this stuff, but also I wanted to try and get some decent Cura profiles together. I've released the profiles now, and there's links to download them and all the info in the description down below. But here I'm going to go through them, why you might want to use them, how to install them, and things you might want to adjust as you print. So first off, why Cura? What's wrong with Snapmaker Luban? Well, there's nothing really wrong with it, but Cura opens up a lot more options to tell the Snapmaker 2 how we want to print the models we want to make. Different models might benefit from some of the new or experimental features that Cura offers, either to improve the quality or the strength of the part, or to simply speed up how long it takes to print. A word of warning though, I do have to say that you use these profiles at your own risk. The official word from Snapmaker is that if you kill your printer because you use third-party software, then your warranty is void, so don't blame me if your printer dies. That being said, I can't see any reason why they should cause an issue, but with that scary disclaimer out of the way, let's get on with it and I'll show you how to install the profiles. If you haven't done so already, the first thing we need to do is to download the setup file for Cura 4.8 from the Cura website. Then we need to run it and keep clicking on next until it's done. When we first load Cura, we're presented with an introduction setup thing and we just keep clicking next until we get to the part where we can add a printer. Here we want to add a non-network printer, but you can see that the Snapmaker 2 doesn't actually exist on the list of profiles supplied with Cura, so we're going to have to add a custom FFF printer. Now, don't worry if you're not keeping up with this, there are screenshots for all these settings and there'll be links to those in the description as well too, but I'm going to call this the Snapmaker 2 A350 and click next where we're faced with our setting options. We'll worry about the start and end G code in a minute, but we'll enter the build volume of the Snapmaker 2 A350, which is 320 for X, 350 for Y and 330 for Z. We're also going to check the box for the heated bed. We're not going to worry about the printhead settings for now, but they're only really important for one particular feature that most people probably won't be using anyway. But I have had a few people asking me about them, so I'm going to go over what all that is in a future video. Just a quick interruption, since recording all this, I've gone and measured the printhead, entered the settings into Cura, and updated the screenshots on the GitHub repository that we'll get to later. So these are the numbers you'll want to enter. For now, there's only one more thing we need to change here, and that's on the extruder tab. The default filament diameter for Cura profiles is 2.85mm, but we're using a printer that uses 1.75mm filament, so we just enter that diameter in here and click next. To actually get the Snapmaker 2 PLA profiles, we have to head over to GitHub. I figured GitHub would be a good place to publish them because it makes it really easy to keep the files updated as I tweak things or add new profiles for different materials. Once on GitHub, and there's a link in the description below, you just need to download the zip containing all the files and then unzip it to a folder on your desktop. When you open up the folder, you'll see that there's a couple of folders inside it containing profiles for a couple of different versions of Cura, along with a couple of text files containing the start and end G codes valid for both versions. We'll start with the G code. Simply double click on the start G-code text file, select everything, copy it, and then head back to Cura. In Cura, click Settings, Printer, Manage Printers, and when the box pops up, click on the Machine Settings button for the Snapmaker 2. Delete everything that's in the start G-code box, and then paste in what we copied from the start G-code text file. Then load up the end G-code text file, copy and paste the contents of that into the end G-code box, and hit Close. On the dialog we're already at, shift down from printers by clicking on profiles. You can see that there are a few standard profiles already. Click on the import button and browse to where the profiles are stored. Make sure you install the version of the profile that's right for the version of Cura you're using. Once you're in the folder where the profiles are stored, double click on one to import it. Here you can see I imported the fast profile and the high quality profile. We'll get to normal in a minute, but with a couple of profiles installed, we can head over to Thingiverse or wherever, download a model, bring it into Cura, and start slicing away. In Cura 4.8, we access our print setting profiles by clicking on this top right section of the bar across the top. You don't see a lot of settings, but if you click on Custom at the bottom, they all appear. From here, you can see that it's selected the fine profile by default, but if we click on the drop-down list, we can see the two profiles we installed. If we click on Manage Profiles at the bottom, we can see that same dialog that we were at before, but it's already on the Profiles tab and we can import our final normal profile. you can see that it instantly gets added to the list of the profiles available to us. Now we just need to choose one, hit slice, and that's it. When it's done, we've got our slice model, and all you need to do is save out the G-code, put it on your USB stick, plug it into the printer, and away you go. Here, I've chosen the high quality setting, and you can see that it prints with a thin 0.08mm layer height, and Cura estimates that it will take around 1 day, 21 hours and 47 minutes, or almost 46 hours. If we slice the file again using the normal settings, it'll take less than half that time at 16 hours and 25 minutes. And with the fast profile, we cut that time about in half again, coming in at a little over 8 hours. And that's pretty much it as far as installing them goes. The normal profile is your general purpose day-to-day profile that's a good balance between speed and quality, and it's the one that I've tweaked the most. It has virtually no stringing and the prints are quite good and solid. The high quality profiles produce finer detail prints because you've got a much lower layer height, but it does seem to produce a little bit more stringing. That's something I'm still planning to work on some more, so I'll update the high quality profile once I've done some more testing and refining of the retraction settings. The fast profile is significantly faster than the other two, although it does come at the expense of quality. Here you're dealing with 0.24mm layer heights, and if all you need are quick prototype prints to do test fits, or they need to be solid but appearance doesn't matter, then this is a great option. There are some settings that you might want to change though, depending on what you need, but until I started recording this and setting up the profiles on a fresh machine, I wasn't aware of exactly how many of those settings Cura hid by default. So for now, I'll go over the settings you might want to change that Cura actually shows by default, and then I'll maybe do another video in the future to take a little deeper dive into some of the hidden settings that you might need to enable. The first thing you might want to change are the wall, top, and bottom thicknesses. These are determined by your nozzle diameter and layer height. If you're using a 0.4mm nozzle and you want a 1.6mm thick wall, that's 4 walls thick. If you want a 2mm wall, that's 5 walls thick. Simple maths. The same sort of calculation is used for the top and bottom layers, except instead of your nozzle diameter, here we're printing with 0.16mm layer height, so if we want a 1mm top thickness, that means we need to print 7 layers high. If we want a 0.8mm thickness, that's 5 layers high, because Cura will always do the minimum amount of layers it needs to get at least that value. More walls and layers will take longer to print, but the model will be more solid as a result. And speaking of more solid, the next thing we want to look at is the infill. I've gone fairly high on these profiles because much of what I print is practical and mechanical parts and they need to be fairly strong. Higher levels of infill can also help increase the quality of top surfaces. But as with more walls, more infill adds more strength, but it does also take more time to print. Dropping the infill down from 15% to 5% in this example drops our print time down from 17 hours and 16 minutes to 11 hours and 25 minutes. So if it's just a decorative piece and you don't really care how strong it is, you can reduce the infill quite a bit to shorten the print time. Speaking of practical and mechanical parts, let's take a look at horizontal expansion. This is essentially the difference between the size your part should be and the size it actually is based on any expansion that might have occurred based on the type of filament you're using. If you find that all your parts are slightly smaller than they should be, and the holes are a little large, you may want to add a little horizontal expansion to make up that difference so that parts fit snugly. Inversely, if your parts are a little bit big and your holes a touch too small, you might want to introduce some negative expansion to bring things in a bit. Now, I did make a couple of files in Fusion 360, which just has a 5mm hole and an 8mm hole and then a couple of holes for bearings. One of these just happens to be the right size for a 608 skateboard bearing. I also made a part that mates up to this, which contains short 5mm and 8mm pegs sticking out. The first pair of parts that I printed used zero horizontal expansion and they don't fit together at all. But I dialed in negative 0.1mm horizontal expansion and printed them again. And you can see that here they fit together just nicely. And if I take a 5mm steel rod, it fits through that hole perfectly. And if we take an 8mm steel rod, it fits through that hole perfectly. And these are machined to ideal sizes really, so if they fit just perfectly, you know your holes are right. And we can take a 608 skateboard bearing and it just slots right into that hole. There, everything fits perfectly with 0.1 millimeters horizontal expansion. How much you need, if any at all, will largely depend on the filament you're using. Even just switching between different brands of the same type of filament, like PLA, can change how much you need. Silk PLA, for example, often tends to need a little tiny bit more than regular PLA. But if size doesn't matter, then don't worry about it. But if you're making functional parts that you need to fit together with other stuff, like we've done here with the camera gimbal, this is something you'll need to experiment with using whatever filament you want to print with. I found that most PLA filaments print quite well at 200 degrees on the nozzle and 60 degrees on the bed. Sometimes though, you might want to change this. I mostly keep the bed at 60 because it helps to ensure that the parts stick given the temperature of the room the printer's in. If your room's a little warmer, you might want to drop the bed down to 50. If it's a little colder, especially at this time of year, you might want to bump it up even a few more degrees. Sometimes you might want to bump the nozzle up for different types of PLA. For example, with silk PLA, I generally have to print that at around 210 degrees to get the same clean prints that I get at 200 with regular PLA. And for PLA Plus, I have to go up to 220. The idea is to print at as low a temperature as possible while still yielding good results. Print speed we're not going to talk about because most of the changes I've made here are in the hidden settings that we'll get back to in another video. Changing this 60 millimeters per second setting here might help you, it might not, I really don't know, because of the hidden settings being overridden. So I'm not advising that you change it right now. The Snapmaker 2 can handle the settings that are in this profile just fine. I'm also not going to go too much into support settings here, except to say that the standard support should work pretty well for most things. Do note though that by default it's set to only produce support material over the bed itself. If you have a part of a model that sits above another part of the model, then support material will not be created. I have added tree support settings to the profile, but as Cura has them hidden by default, that will be for a future video. I printed this over Christmas on a live stream, as some of you might have remembered, but I've saved pulling off the supports for now because I wanted to show them on video so you could see how easy tree supports come off compared to other types of support. It will pull off fairly easily. There we go. There we go, and that's all the support material off. It needs a little bit of cleanup around the edges to get rid of this brim. The supports have come off really, really easily, and it looks nice and clean underneath where all the support material was. Build plate adhesion is a setting you might want to change depending on the model you're printing. The two main options you see are skirt and brim. The skirt essentially runs a ring of filament around the model, and then at the end it stops, moves in and starts printing the model. This is what I normally use. A brim, on the other hand, creates a ring of filament around your model similar to a skirt, except that it actually touches your model and extends out as a flat base. This can be super handy to give the base of your model some more surface area to help it stick. This is something I use with Donkey Kong print because he has relatively small feet on the bed holding a big mass up top. If I printed without the brim around his feet, there was a big chance that as the model got higher up, he'd come unstuck. Like I said though, normally I just print a skirt as the base is often the biggest part of the model. So that's pretty much it for now. I hope you guys find these files useful. As I said, I will keep updating them as I come across issues in my own prints and tweak them some more, and you'll always find the latest versions of them on GitHub. But let me know down in the comments below if you have any problems with them or if you need help, and I'll try to get back to you as soon as I can. I want to thank everybody who stopped by the live streams over the past couple of months asking questions and chatting, especially those of you who donated to the channel through Super Chat. If you like this video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up and subscribe if you want to see more. Again, if you have any questions or there's something you'd like to see me make a video about, drop them down in the comments below. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.